a love of our Savior God, a love that is all-encompassing, all-forgiving. May that love be with you. May that love unite us all for Jesus' sake. Amen. The Word of God that we consider from the book of John, the 17th chapter, verses 20 to 26. I know it was already read, but these words aren't real familiar, so we're going to read it again. Jesus says, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me. May they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those who have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Gracious Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be."
Talking about the very special unity that exists between himself and his heavenly Father.
upon. We all understand, right, that God is triune, that there are three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, yet one God. The Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God, yet not three gods, but one. Okay? There is one God who we know as the triune God. And yet Jesus Christ, even though completely separate from the Father, remember the baptism of Jesus, two separate people. And yet at the same time, Jesus said, I and the Father are one. We are united. That's the point he makes here. I and the Father are one. As one united God. God has one united purpose. And that is that everybody enjoys forever heaven, the glory, the bliss of heaven forever. That one united God has one desire, and that is that all believers remain united. That all believers be united in Jesus Christ, just as the Father and Son are one, that we believers be one in Jesus Christ. In other words, he's simply saying, I want all of you to be a part of my family. And on our own, I think we all understand that's impossible. You know what Jesus said, right? Or the Lord had the Apostle Paul write, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. And we go, everything written in the book of the law? We can't even get past that first commandment without stumbling. We don't love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, and strength every single moment of every single day of every of our life. We break that very first commandment. The Lord tells us the result of breaking those commandments. He'll say to us, I love you. Just like we do with our children when we discipline them, I love you. But Jesus would say, I love you, but because of your sin, you have to depart from me into the eternal fire. But what was impossible for us to be united as a family with Jesus Christ is not impossible. And I hope you'll take this in the way it's intended. But as we think of God's plan of salvation, we understand that the love that God has for us is insane. That God's plan of salvation is crazy what he did. I mean, stop to think about it. God, the Father, charged his Son. His Son, who kept not only the first, but all 10 commandments perfectly, he charged his Son with our failure to love God most. And then he treated his Son, who he loved with a perfect love. He treated his Son as if he was the most heinous criminal sinner of all time. He crucified him. He damned him. And then after that, it's like God said, oh, now I feel better. Now my anger for sin is satisfied. I feel better. And now the ransom for the sins of the whole world has been paid. I feel better. You know what that means now? That means that our spirit, word, faith in Jesus Christ, we have become the sons and daughters of the Heavenly Father. That means that God has made it possible for us to be united with Jesus Christ. God's plan, crazy as it seems, God's plan worked. You and I are forgiven, and by faith in Jesus Christ, we are united with our Heavenly Father in that one family. Jesus' prayer for you. Not that just that we be united with the Father, but that he prays for all believers of all time that we be united with one another. He said the world may, he said, whoops, excuse me, just as you are me and I in them, may they also be in us. May we together be united with Jesus Christ. Jesus is simply praying that every believer walk with Jesus Christ, and every believer remain steadfastly grounded on Jesus Christ. He's praying for the unity of the Christian church. He's praying that all believers families of all time, of all places, be united as one family in Jesus Christ. And that's what happens whenever the gospel is proclaimed. You know what the gospel is, right? It's the power of God for salvation. And our God tells us that His word, His gospel, will not return to Him empty. Where the gospel is proclaimed, the Holy Spirit is at work. Faith is created. Faith is maintained. The family of believers is established. And Jesus is praying for all believers of all times, of all places, that we remain united in that one family of God. For a purpose. Jesus also prays that that purpose be carried out as well. He said, may they be brought to complete unity. To let the world know that you sent me and have loved me even as you have loved them, even as you have loved me. Let the world know. That's our purpose for existing as sons and daughters of the Heavenly Father. That's why God has given us life in His family, so that we can let the world know of God's insane love for them, of God's crazy plan to eradicate their sins, to walk them through death, to help them get around hell, to lead them to the joy of eternal life. That's what God wants us to do. To let this world know that salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which they must be saved except that of Jesus Christ. And the best way that we can tell people about Jesus is to talk to people. Telling people of their forgiveness through Jesus Christ. Talking to people about their eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. But then there are nonverbal ways that we can do that as well. Well, if we can dig up a few of the New Testament people, if we can get the New Testament people to say, hey, what impressed you about Jesus when Jesus was on this earth? I mean, what just really caught your attention about Jesus? What do you suppose they'd say? You know what I think they'd say? His selflessness. His kindness. His desire to help anyone at any time for any reason. Well, guess what? If we live a selfless life, if we live a kind life, what are we doing? We're reflecting the love of Jesus to the people of this world without saying a word. Through our active worship, our regular worship, our joyful worship. What are we doing? We're reflecting the love that we have for Jesus Christ through our obedience to His holy word. What are we doing? We're telling this world, here's how much I respect Jesus. I'm going to do what He wants me to do. So in so many nonverbal ways, we can reflect the love of Jesus and let this world know about the love of Jesus. Then Jesus' prayer for unity of the church just concludes this way. He said, righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you. And they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known. In order that the love you have for me may be in them, that I myself may be in them. The key phrase in that longer section there is just this. We'll continue to make you known. That's Jesus' prayer. That Jesus continue to be made known to us. And you know how that happens? The Apostle Paul answers the question when he said, faith comes from hearing. Hear the word of God. We have that chance every day in our homes when we open up the Bible and just read a couple of verses. We have that opportunity every week when we gather in the house of the Lord to hear His word. And through that word, the Holy Spirit works. Through that word, the Holy Spirit shows us God's love. Love that forgives, love that saves, love that creates, love that maintains faith. And that's what Jesus is praying for you. You guys understand this?
that you remain faithful to hear.
Now just, sorry, but we have to just add a word of warning, okay? Just something we need to be prepared. We cherish the unity that we have with every believer, all times, all places. But we have to remember what the Lord said about His Word. He wants us to preach faith. We do not have the right to add any teachings. We don't have the right to rip away any teachings. We don't have the right to change God's Word at all. Even if it doesn't match with human reason, even if it doesn't seem to fit the society's view. Remember, God is the author of the Bible. God is perfect. His Word is perfect. And the Lord simply tells us, let the one who has my Word speak it faithfully. And so He warns us to watch out for those who change His Word. To watch out for those who change His Word, because those change teachings, Paul said, and spread like gangrene and destroy our faith. So cherish the unity that we have with all Christians who believe in Jesus Christ. But be careful that you don't compromise the truth of God's Word by reducing the possibility of danger. No, the sermon's not over, sorry. You can look at the printed manuscript, three more paragraphs, and then we right on, that's right. Okay, but anyway. I thought that's what the child said. But the prayer of Jesus for the church concludes this way. He said, Father, I want those who have given to me to be with me where I am and see my Word. Jesus' prayer for you is that we get to see His glory. Not a glimpse of the glory of Jesus like the disciples saw on the Mount of Transfiguration, but that we get to see the full-blown glory of Jesus Christ. You know what He's saying, right? He's praying that we remain faithful to Him until the point of our death so that we can enjoy living in the glory of heaven. The glory of heaven, where there is an absence of worry and fear and doubt. The glory of heaven where there is an absence of all sickness, no flus, no influenzas, no colds, no allergies, no asthma, no bad health. The glory of heaven where there's an absence of school struggles and work worries. The glory of heaven where there is no more death, not my own, not the death of a loved one. That's what Jesus is praying for. How determined Jesus is to make sure that you get to live in heaven. Again, on your own is impossible, because the Lord says that if you want to live in heaven on your own, all you have to do is be perfect. And as we look at these verses, if we're to pick out one sin that we commit, I think it would be something with regarding prayer, because Jesus is praying for us. And that's what God wants us to do. He tells us to pray continually. He tells us to pray for one another. And if I were to ask you right now, for whom did you pray this morning? Someone sitting in this building, for whom did you pray this morning? And if you would name a name, I would say, praise God. And I would say, fantastic. But then I would also say, do you realize the Lord wants us to pray for someone else? The Lord said, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. The Lord wants us to pray even for our enemies, and then we go, holy cats, I don't do that. We're sinning, which means I can't go to heaven. We're sinning, which means I deserve to go to hell. But then we remember Jesus. That same love that made a crazy plan to save the world from the curse of their sins. He said, Jesus, here's my plan. You go down to this earth. You keep the law. hang on the cross till he's dead. As his heavenly Father demanded of him, suffering our curse, satisfying God's anger, paying for our sins, so that God, our Father, could tell us the sweetest news ever. I forgive you. I forgive you all your sins. And then to make the greatest promise he could ever make, that if we believe in the Lord Jesus, we will be saved. Guys, that's Jesus' prayer for you. That you remain faithful to the point of death. So that you can someday wear the crown of life. The love that Jesus Christ has for each and every one of us. It's insane. Who loves like that? Ready to do everything necessary to forgive you, prepare a place in heaven. And then after all of that, he doesn't ascend up there into heaven and do nothing. No, he's sitting there, he's praying for you. Praying that all believers remain united in Jesus Christ. And praying for you. That your faith lives in your heart until your last breath. Rise.